Hey guys, Ms. Marusik here, and in this video, we're going to be talking about Maxwell-Boltzmann distribution curves of gases. Now, if you're one of my students, I'm going to strongly encourage you to answer the examples both on this page as well as on the next page before you watch this video. These examples were designed more as an inquiry activity, so that way you can kind of process your own learning here. You'll get a lot more out of it if you do that. Now, if you've already worked the examples and you just want to get some clarification and make sure you have the right answers, I'm about to go through all of the examples so that way you can feel confident with what you've put down. So to get us started here, on model one, they gave us a graph where they showed helium at different temperatures. You notice on the side here, we had number of particles. Down here, we had particle speed, and our three different curves were at negative 100, positive 100, and positive 500 degrees Celsius. Now, something I want to point out about these curves. The idea is that on all three of these curves, the area underneath the curves is the same, that the total number of particles at all three of these temperatures is equivalent, but the way those particles are distributed as far as the particle speed is different depending on the temperature. And so those are some of the conclusions that we're going to make here. How does that distribution change for those different temperatures, even though the total number of particles is remaining consistent? So the first question asked, hey, how would the amount of total kinetic energy of the sample at negative 100 compare to the total kinetic energy of the other samples? And hopefully we recognize the fact that kinetic energy is directly proportional to temperature. As kinetic energy goes up, the temperature goes up. And so because negative 100 was the lowest of the temperatures, it would have the lowest kinetic energy of the samples that they gave us. So then it said, hey, examine the bell curve that represents the temperature of 100 degrees Celsius. Do all of the molecules at that temperature move at the same speed? So I go up here and look and I say, okay, well, the curve at 100 degrees Celsius was this middle curve here that had the shorter dashes to it. And I see that there's some molecules moving at zero, there's some moving at 1,000, there's some moving at 2,000, and I even have some up here moving at like 3,500 and maybe even a little bit more. So I see a wide range there of speeds occurring for the particles at 100 degrees Celsius. They are not all moving at the same speed. If they were, I would see more of a bar graph situation versus that bell curve distribution. So that's the key thing here that I want us to understand, is that at a particular temperature, we have some particles that are moving slow, we have some particles that are moving fast. We get that range of speeds there. Now, I put a range here of 0 meters per second up to approximately 3,800. You might have put a little bit different range there, but the key thing is I want us to see that it is a range of speeds. It's not just one speed in particular. So then it asks, hey, what would the average speed of the molecules be for each of our temperatures? And so I kind of ballparked an approximation of where my peaks were at. You might have had a different value here, so that's why I put a range on these. You probably had an exact value, which is fine. Really, the key thing I wanted us to see here is that as we increase our temperature, the speed, the average speed of those molecules do increase. However, those ranges are expanding. So I'm getting, again, an increase in speed as I increase my temperature, but the range, the expansion of that graph is growing. So it says here, hey, as temperature increases, what happens to the average particle speed? Hopefully we noted as temperature increased, the average speed of the molecules increases, which is not surprising. We would have probably expected that. But then it asks, what happens to the shape of the bell curve as the temperature increases? And hopefully we notated that the bell curves are flattening and stretching out. Last year, some of my students were joking that these look like the flatten the curve COVID-19 graphs. And I'm like, yeah, they kind of do, except that here we are keeping the area underneath these the same. And so we do have the same number of particles with each of these graphs. But in order to get those increased averages, those increased speeds for the peaks, what we're having to do is stretch out and flatten that graph in order to ensure that the area underneath the graph is remaining consistent for all three of those curves. So on the last question down here, it asked us to draw in a curve to represent a temperature above 500 degrees Celsius. So again, what I wanted to do is if I'm above 500, if I'm above the highest temperature here, then I wanted to flatten it and stretch it out. And so this was my curve I drew from above 500 degrees Celsius. Again, my peak of this should be shifted to the right at an increased particle speed of the rest of these, and that range of speeds should be increased. So here's the key thing I want us to take away from this. Notice that at a particular temperature, I get a range of speeds. Some particles at 500 degrees Celsius are moving really slow. Some are moving really fast. But the average peak of those graphs is increasing for an increasing temperature, which causes the peak to flatten out. All right, so to look at the question on the next page that ties to this, it said, circle the set of drawings below that more accurately illustrates the difference in particle speeds for helium at both 100 and 500 degrees Celsius. Well, hopefully we know that at 500 degrees Celsius, my particles should be moving faster than at 100 degrees Celsius. And they gave us a hint here that the longer the arrow, the faster the particle is moving. So I should see longer arrows at 500 than I see at 100. Now, for both of these situations, I see that. I have shorter arrows at 100 and longer arrows at 500. Okay, so there must be some other difference between these two images. And if I look more carefully at this first one, I notice that at a particular temperature, all of the arrows are exactly the same length, which would indicate that all of the speeds are exactly the same at that temperature, which we know from our discussion just a moment ago that that's not the case. At a particular temperature, we see a range of speeds. Some are moving slow, some are moving fast, but the particular average of it tells us where that temperature is at. So this second picture is a lot better because what it's trying to show here is that we are getting an average of various different speeds. So some of these are going slower, some of them are going faster, and that average is giving us our temperature of 100 degrees Celsius. Same goes for this one. Overall, I have longer arrows, even though I still have some short ones and some long ones. And so again, that average would be higher for that higher temperature. So the second set is again better because it shows a range of speeds at a particular temperature. Now, this second graph was very different than the first one. The first graph showed one particular gas at different temperatures. This graph is showing different gases all at the same temperature. All of the gases here happen to be part of the noble gas family. And so I notice again the kind of shift that we see in the shape of these curves. Some of the curves are taller and skinnier, whereas some are flattened and stretched out. However, again, just like on the previous graph, the area underneath these curves should be the same to represent the same number of particles that we have in all of these samples. So the first question on this one said, hey, how would the amount of total kinetic energy of each of the noble gases compared to the kinetic energy of the others? Make a statement that justifies your decision. Well, this one was kind of a trick question. If I notice back up here, it told us that they were all at 100 degrees Celsius. And if they are at the same temperature, then that means their kinetic energy should be the same. Now, I know some of you are going to look at that and be like, but Ms. Marusik, some of these are moving at different average speeds. I agree, but here's the issue. Kinetic energy is tied to temperature. However, kinetic energy is equal to 1/2 mv squared. Those of you that have taken physics are probably familiar with that formula, Ke equals 1/2 mv squared. We're going to talk about it more in a video that you're going to watch after this one. But what that basically means is that kinetic energy is impacted by both m, mass, and v, velocity. And so the speed, the velocity, can vary depending on what the mass of the molecule is, even though the kinetic energy value might be exactly the same. And so that really impacts us here on these graphs. So again, that was a trick question. They were all the same kinetic energy because they all had the same temperature. So then it said, hey, determine the molar mass of each of the gases shown in the graph above. And I gave kind of a ballpark figure here for each of these. So if you wrote down a more specific molar mass, that's totally fine. I just wrote down enough that I could then answer some of these next questions here. It said, which noble gas has the slowest average particle speed at 100 degrees Celsius? So again, the slowest average speed would be the peak that has shifted more back towards our origin, which for that would be this solid curve here, which is representative of xenon. Yes, it's taller, but that's because more of my molecules have this reduced speed of their particle. It asks then which noble gas has the fastest average particle speed. And again, the peak itself would need to be shifted more to the right. And so that would belong to this dotted line here, which is helium. The only reason the graph is flattened out is because as that peak shifts over, that range expands. And so to keep the area under the graph the same, to keep the same total number of particles, I've got to flatten out that curve. So then, on the next question, it says, describe the relationship between the molar mass of particles and the average particle speed. So hopefully we recognize that as molar mass increased, as I got to this xenon here at 131 grams per mole, that gave me a slower average speed. So as molar mass increased, the speed of the molecules decreases. Now, the next question said, hey, I have a lovely curve here that's representative of fluorine gas, and then wanted to sketch an approximate curve for chlorine gas at the same temperature, 100 degrees Celsius, on the same graph. And so this is where I would need some molar mass information about my two gases. So I looked up fluorine's diatomic molar mass, which is 38 grams per mole, 19 times 2. And then chlorine on its own is 35.45 times 2, since it's diatomic, would be 70.9 gram per mole. So I see that chlorine is a heavier molecule than fluorine is. So if it's a heavier molecule, then it should be moving at a slower speed. Now, a slower speed would mean that my graph gets shifted back toward the origin, the range of speeds becomes reduced, but the peak of that graph would increase because I need to have the same area under the graph. So I kind of drew a ballpark curve here. It might not be perfect, but again, the key things I would want to look for is a curve that was reduced in its range, that the average of the peak was at a lower speed than fluorine, and a curve that was taller so that the area underneath this is roughly about the same as the area under the fluorine. All right, hopefully we're feeling okay with interpreting these Maxwell-Boltzmann distribution curves. I see these questions a lot on the multiple choice part of the AP test. They might give you some graphs and ask you, hey, you know, if this was the original graph, what would the new graph look like if I change the molar mass or change the temperature? And so you're really going to have to know what kind of changes occur in these graphs as we change those conditions. So hopefully we're feeling good about making those conclusions. If you have any questions or need any help, please feel free to email me. Bye, guys.